Welcome you to the second of our Ecology Center Seminar Series talks for this month, and to introduce today's speaker, who's Dr. Merav Ben-David from University of Wyoming, the Department of Zoology and Physiology. I'm really pleased to introduce her. I've admired her work for a very long time. So Dr. Ben-David is from Israel, and where she grew up on a small family farm and learned to love nature and work hard outside, and she's carried that with her for the rest of her life. She served in the military in Israel, in the Israeli Air Force, and then she got degrees in biology and zoology from University of Tel Aviv, and then worked as a wildlife guide in Kenya, after which she moved to the United States and completed a PhD in wildlife biology at University of Alaska in Fairbanks. She stayed on there doing research as a postdoc for a few years, and I'm pretty sure that that work was the Exxon Valdez oil spill teamwork, right? So an important study that continues to be used today. She's an accomplished and influential wildlife ecologist with expertise that ranges from behavior and physiology to population conservation and ecosystem feedbacks and effects. She has long-running research on river otters and on polar bears, and has worked with many, many other mammals as well, especially carnivores, but not exclusively so. She's been recognized many times and in many ways for the high quality of her work. She's a fellow of the Wildlife Society. She's the editor-in-chief of Wildlife Monographs. She won the Wildlife Society Excellence in Wildlife Education Award. She won the Distinguished Service Award from the Wyoming chapter of the Wildlife Society. She was named the Conservation Educator of the Year by the Wyoming Wildlife Federation, and she's been named the University of Wyoming T.S. Harris Outstanding Faculty more than once. She also received the Barrett Hamilton Distinguished Ecology Award from the University of Manitoba for her work, her contributions to conservation of polar bears. She won, with a team of people, the award for Outstanding Monograph from the Wildlife Society from the work I mentioned before on the Exxon Valdez oil spill and its influence on river otters and the recovery of river otters. She moved a whole lot farther into civic service in 2019. Her work has always been widely applied, so conservation relevant, environmental management relevant, but she took it up a notch and ran for a U.S. Senate seat from the state of Wyoming. I thought one of the highlights of her campaign was a video that was produced about science and how scientists get things done. And if you've never watched that, you should Google her and find her Ben-David campaign site and watch it. It's only about 30 seconds long, and it's terrific. It will make you feel wonderful about the power you have as a scientist to make a difference in the world. I will leave the rest of the program to Dr. Ben-David, who will talk about when the climate warms up, will social relationships cool down?
Hi, everyone. Good to see you again. The most important part is it's a furry tale. On March 24th, 1989, a Black Friday, the Exxon Valdez supertanker ran aground on Bly Reef in the north part of Prince William Sound, spilled millions and millions of gallons of crude oil into one of the most pristine environments on our globe in Prince William Sound, and caused an environmental disaster. I'm not going to tell you a single thing about all our work on the Exxon Valdez oil spill, but if you are interested in learning a little bit more about it, you can ask me later. What I'm going to tell you is what we learned as we were working on coastal river otters in Alaska, in Prince William Sound, following the Exxon Valdez oil spill. What we found is that coastal river otters in Prince William Sound have a very high variation in sociality. Some animals were solitary and remained solitary year round. Others were social and highly social, and they were found in large groups, sometimes up to 21 individuals. Let me show you what some of these social groups look like. One of them playing with a camera. Looks like ants, not like otters, right? Our study area was very large, encompassed the northwest part of Prince William Sound, about 4,800 square kilometers. Obviously a very hard area to survey. There are no roads. The only places you can get to are via boat or float planes. But using telemetry and radio implants, we were able to track quite a few individuals. And what we found is that the differences in sociality were mainly gender-based. Let's see if this works. It does. Groups or animals that showed high levels of sociality were mostly males, whereas females were either social or occurred very infrequently in small groups. Not only that, when we looked at group composition, we found that most groups were male-only groups or had an occasional female join them. Whereas if there was a female group, most of them were mixed groups. They also contained the males. This telemetry data obtained immediately after the Exxon Valdez oil spill was a cause of a major fight between me and my then PhD student, Adiba Rokas, who claimed that we didn't sample in a fine grain enough the interactions of the otters because we had to fly telemetry. So he came up with a new method called proximity tags, which now I know you're using here in some of the coyote work. And we captured river otters and we glued proximity tags to their backs and let them go and then set up the logging stations at their latrines, and they downloaded the logs from every tag that came onto the latrine. And we found exactly the same thing. A very classic fission-fusion type of society with males splitting and joining groups, sometimes very large groups, sometimes small ones. Here you see a trace of such interactions. An example, where's the marker? Here it is. So animals join groups, leave groups, and spend time with groups or not. All of these were males. None of the females we tagged ever interacted or came around a male or another female. So immediately you think, okay, why are some animals highly social and some are not? Is there any effect of kin? For that, we used DNA microsatellite analysis, and we genotyped 110 individuals at 10 loci. And what we found, I mean, the very nice species-specific loci, as you see in this trace. And using this data, we calculated relatedness and used the coefficient of relatedness versus the data from the telemetry to calculate, either dynamic interactions, which are checking who is next to who within a certain time period, or another measure of frequency of association. And what you see is that there is actually no pattern, no relationship between relatedness and sociality. We took another approach and looked at it from the inclusive fitness type of approach and looked how many individual otters have relatives in the population and compared social with unsocial, non-social otters. And you see that very few otters have very highly close relatives, such as parents, offspring, or immediate littermates that are highly related to each other. And most of the animals in the population are not at all related to each other, but there is no difference between social and asocial, non-social animals, whether you look at specific bays in our study area or the overall study area. Okay, so we had to conclude that sociality is not kin-based and does not offer inclusive fitness. But what about direct fitness? Do social animals have higher direct fitness, have more offspring? So we looked at, again, percent sociality, and then looked at number of offspring from the genetic profiles. And as you can see, there are a lot of otters who don't have any offspring. And these were all adults that could have had offspring. So not everybody successfully reproduces, but there is no relationship to sociality. You can be asocial or social, male or female, and have the same number of offspring. So we had to conclude that sociality is not a function or does not affect direct fitness in otters. I can only get that to work. There we go. This is a famous river otter dance. River otters scent mark by flicking their tails and defecating and urinating while doing so. A very interesting behavior on its own. And that was a mama and three cubs. So we said, okay, it's not kinship. How about anti-predator adaptation? Maybe being social offers some protection. And you can imagine that when you are surveying 48 square kilometers with boats and planes, you're not likely to see a predation event, especially since you're dealing with a marine environment and the main predators are orcas and sea lions, and you can barely see orcas even when they're there. So we came up with prediction that we could explore with otter behavior to try and see if it was related to predation. And we predicted that females with young would be more social because of potential predation by bald eagles on cubs. Otters should be more social in periods where these with predators have no alternative prey. And the main alternative prey for these predators in this system is salmon. When salmon comes in, these predators exclusively switch to feed on salmon. So that would give a relief to otters. They don't have to be as social during those times. And then we thought, well, a larger group would be more bold and able to forage further away from shore because there are more eyes and whiskers to feel predators coming. So here are the same data I showed you before for male and female and group size, this time separated by the month of the year, females on the bottom, males on the top. And what you see is the average minimum group size. And what you see that males are always more social than females. Females are basically solitary at one. But also what you see is that group size of males increases in basically May, June, July, and August. And that turns out to be the period where most of these prey fish come into the system. We also found a negative correlation between group size and distance to shore, but it was not biologically meaningful. So we had to conclude that it's not anti-predator adaptation. We would expect the increase in group size in the winter months, not in the summer months. Back to our original square one. Why are some otters social and some are not? And river otters have two types of prey available to them in a nearshore environment. The first, the most ubiquitous and temporally stable are intertidal fish and subtidal fish, such as this red Irish lord, other sculpin, grinling, rockfish, ronquil, a lot of intertidal, subtidal fish. They occupy territories along the coast in an intertidal and subtidal, and they're very stable. And if there is a predation event, a fish is depredated, the territory is immediately filled by another from the species. So it's a very stable food source. However, it's not very nutritious. All these fish, their main anti-predator adaptation is a lot of spines and quills, and actually there is more bony parts to them than there is muscle. I don't know how many of you have tried to skin a sculpin, I mean fillet a sculpin. There's nothing to it. So they're not very beneficial nutritionally. The alternative prey are these schooling pelagic fishes. These are capelin, herring, sandlin, salmon. They come into the system to spawn. They spend most of their life in a deep ocean, in the Gulf of Alaska, and they come to the nearshore environment to spawn. They form these large spawning aggregation, these schools, and the biomass in these schools can be enormous. Just think about the size of the trees here and the size of these fish schools. These are trees that can be 20 meters tall. So there is a huge biomass of highly nutritious fish that have no spines. They have high lipid contents because they have to migrate and then rely on resources they bring with them to create their eggs and sperm. So they're very highly nutritious fish. The main adaptation for anti-predation by these fish schools is actually when they are attacked by a single predator, what they do, like here the salmon attacking some sandlins, the school splits, the fish swim erratically, the shiny part of them is confusing, and the predator may at most be able to catch one of them. What the predators do is surround the fish school and clump them together so they can't adopt this behavior. And then any individual predator can grab multiple fish, as you see here with the puffins working together. Think of a bowhead whale or a humpback whale, mostly humpback, you know, with a bubble net. You're familiar with them. That's basically the same as having multiple predators surround a fish school. They put out the bubbles constrain the fish, they pick up and pull them in. So this is what otters have to select for. So we wanted to know what the otters eat in Prince William Sound. So we used stable isotope analysis. And basically we can trace food webs and dietary relationships using carbon and nitrogen, just to show you how we can create an isoscape for any project. And this is what the fish in Prince William Sound, Alaska look like. Intertidal fish such as sculpins and rockfish and greenling look like. These are these intertidal, subtidal fish. These are the herring, capelin, salmon, pelagic fish. There are a few small freshwater fish that really are dolly varden and hardly in three spines. Sculpins and sticklebacks, sorry, and the otters really don't feed much on them. So this is what otters have isotopically available. When we caught every otter, we pulled hair off of them, and then we separated the guard hair from the under fur, because otters rely on their fur for thermoregulation, and so they never molt at once. They first replace all the under fur, and when they're done with growing all the new under fur, then they molt and replace the guard hair, which is not what dogs and bears and other animals do, but they just can't afford not to have some insulation diving in cold water. So basically that gives us a time window to two periods. The first one is August and May, and then August through November. And what you see in these plots are each dot here has a matching dot here, just different hair, and males and females. And what you see is that there is a dietary shift from this feeding to this feeding. And what you see is the shift is happens mostly in the males and less so in the females. looking at the same thing, just looking at carbon, because carbon and nitrogen are highly correlated, doesn't matter which one you look at. We now separated them, not based on sex, but based on sociality. And it's again equivalent because the females are less social than the males. So in the low sociality, mostly you have the females, and in the high sociality, mostly the male. The underfill and the guard hill, both these are animals that feed largely on intertidal fish, and they don't change what they eat when the fish come into the system. And here are the males already eating more pelagic fish and having a significant shift to more pelagic fish later on. So we had an inclination that sociality had to do something with foraging and probably cooperatively foraging on these pelagic fish when they become available. But we wanted to test it, and we had the good fortune of having 15 male river otters in captivity for the oiling experiments related to the Exxon Valdez oil spill. But given that we had them there for 10 months, we conducted a lot of other tests on them. And one of the tests was trying to find out if cooperatively foraging increases the capture success of the different fish. We offered them a pink salmon, a group of pink salmon, about 3 to 5 fish in a big tank where they would forage, and then also offer them hornquail and rockfish and sculpins that we ended up going fishing out in Resurrection Bay, which was a lot of fun. And then we tested them for 30 minutes, let them forage as single individuals, and compared the time to first capture of a fish. Now, the intertidal fish had a fish habitat from PVC pipes that they could hide in. It's not fair to just throw a rockfish in the middle of a pool with no cover. So there was a fish habitat. The fish were allowed to acclimate to it and hide in it before we let the otters in. And whether we, you know, it doesn't matter what the fish tries to do and hide, otters were able, all the otters that participated in the experiment caught at least one intertidal, tidal fish, subtidal fish, and did so much faster than any salmon. Some of them never were able to catch salmon on their own. As soon as we let more than one otter forage together, immediately they started cooperating, and the success of catching a pink salmon went down significantly. Now, when we had more than 4 otters and 5 pink salmon in that tank, it was such a boiling water event that success went a little bit high. It wasn't as good, but still way better than a single otter. And when you look at the timing of increase in otter sociality that I showed you before, now males and females are plotted on the same figure. And again, the males' group sizes increases. That corresponds very well with the timing of spawning of all these schooling pelagic fish. And the nail in the coffin is that we looked spatially at the location of the fish schools from the data from the fisheries people, and then our telemetry data, and we overlay them on each other. And what we found is that when you look at 48-hour windows, there's no difference in the timing of social and non-social otters, the distance to these fish schools. But if you look at close time windows, 18 hours and less, you see that social otters are found closer to fish schools than non-social otters, meaning they're targeting them, they're seeking them, they're coming next to them. So it's not kinship, it's not predation, it's cooperative foraging on schooling pelagic fishes that determine sociality of river otters. Great. But why males are more social than females? It would make sense for the female to target those high quality, high energy fish that come in high abundance into the system. Why not the female? They should be the social one. Well, the truth of the matter is, after working on a system for 30 years now, I don't know. We don't know. We have no idea, but we do have a hypothesis. And what we think is, When a female is reproductive, she has pups in the den. She's limited in how far she can go away. So she's a forager that is tied to a central location, and she can't go very far. And so she can only join a male group that is foraging on a fish school if they happen to be within a distance she can leave the pups in the den. But in years when she's not reproductive, then or she loses her litter, she can then join an existing male group. And that's what we see. We see male groups that are joined by females occasionally. The females leave them later, okay? So that's all. Working hypothesis. Okay, cute, huh? You guys like it? Great. Who cares? Who cares? Well, we should care, because the whole system is driven by what is happening in the atmosphere and the interaction between the atmosphere and the ocean, because that determines the abundance of these schooling pelagic fishes and salmon. And when these forage fish and salmon come close to shore, a lot of fish predators, including bears and seabirds and otters and mink and many, 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 the list goes on and on. Fish predators prey on them. And then because they're only they're terrestrial or semi-aquatic, they have a lot of activity sites like latrine sites on land. And this defecation and urination by these fish predators on the landscape and the carcasses they bring on shore basically creates a nutrient flux from sea to land. And then that fertilizes both the plant and microbial community, affects the whole ecosystem processes along the shoreline. And if you're an ecosystem ecologist, you say, how much nitrogen can these otters bring to shore, right? Don't make me laugh. Well, I'm not gonna make you laugh, because otters consume about 10% of the body mass a day. And that's about a kilogram of fish. It's about 40 grams nitrogen. They will excrete, unless they're pregnant or lactating, they will excrete 99% of it. If you have one otter per 2.7 kilometers, each will receive 536 kilograms of nitrogen per year. But otters don't just defecate all along the shoreline. They have these concentrated latrines that are about every 700 meters and about 50 meters meter squared in size. And those are averages. Basically every meter square will get 75 grams of nitrogen a year. In Prince William Sound, we have double the density. And so each meter square of a latrine gets about 160 grams of nitrogen a year. 160 grams doesn't sound like a lot, unless you're a gardener. This is what the surrounding vegetation gets. The non-latrine site vegetation gets 0.01 to 0.02 grams of nitrogen per meter square per year. So we're talking about orders of magnitude more. So I just showed you that the number of otters makes a difference, right? Because I said one otter per 2.7 kilometers or 1.3 kilometers. So the density of otters makes a difference. But I lied. Because the question is, why do otters use these latrine sites? And I showed you the mother otter doing her little otter dance in front of her cubs. And all otters do that. They communicate with each other using these excretions. And there were quite a few hypotheses out there that it is communication between females and males about reproductive status, that it is marking a territory, or it is, if, given that we know we are dealing with large groups, that it is communication between groups or within a group. So we did, with the same captive otters we had, we did some experiments, scent marking experiments. And what we did is we collected excretions from zoo otters, not our own animals, but from zoos, from Oregon Zoo and Seattle Aquarium. And they were all kind enough to send us very well sealed jars with otter feces and anal jellies. And we collected males and females, not estrus females. We all know what estrus does to males. We don't need to test that. But there were non-estrus females and males unfamiliar to our group. And we tested them. And what you see is that, interestingly enough, the males were way more interested in other male scent than they were in non-estrus females. And it turns out that the social hierarchy determined your behavior. And we did a lot of behavioral observations and created a network of our captive. These are all animals in one enclosure. And what you see is that outside of their breeding season, the otters are all very social. There are dominant animals. The centrality of these animals is higher than these animals. And when these animals we determined were the dominant animals and these were the subordinate ones. And it became even more clear during the breeding season. You see there are very few central animals that interact with all the others, and these are animals that drop out of the network. So using the social network, we determine who is a dominant and who is a subordinate animal. And then we looked at how they responded to scent of familiar and unfamiliar male otters, this time only males. And what you see is that dominant otters spent more time investigating scent than subordinate animals. It didn't matter if it was familiar or unfamiliar. And we concluded that this whole scent marking behavior among males is related to social dominance. But still, a number of animals is important. And our main challenge was to determine how many otters there are, because you can trap otters. We have trapped hundreds of them, but you can't recapture them because, like coyotes, Julie, they see one get trapped. You will never trap anyone else in that group ever again. Of probably close to 500 otter captures, we had 6 recaptures. One of them was one female that would call 3 times, and she was so old, I think she was senile. So we had to develop non-invasive genetic sampling. And we, of course, use anal gland secretions, which have 100% otter cells DNA in them. They don't contain hardly any fish, so they work the best. But we also collected feces and extracted DNA from them. And then my student, John DePew, back in the day, developed a single capture hair snail that we set on otter trails on the latrines, and we get nice hair samples. Using the same approach as I showed you earlier with microsatellite DNA analysis, we can sample latrines repeatedly, multiple occasions, and get capture histories. And for example, here is a capture history of an otter in our study area. Using that, we can use open or closed or robust design capture-recapture models. Here is just an example of some of our models. We can estimate survival, apparent survival. It still amazes me that we can estimate survival using poop, but we can. And what you see is that when we look at the larger study area, you know, we estimated this amount, this number of animals. When we looked at the core area, this was the amount. And then we compared these just to make sure we are not estimating anything that is not reliable. We looked at the population reconstruction, and we got 65 individuals for the core area, so pretty close. And then we did survival non-fate estimates using the telemetry. And again, either you get 1 or 0.9, which is what we got from our survival estimates. But the key is that otters change their behavior because it depends on where the fish school is, and they move around, especially those males that scent mark and advertise their social dominance. So what you do, what we did is we counted scats in every latrine site in 2 years, and you see that basically they create hotspots of fertilization, and these hotspots change over time on the landscape. So what does that fertilization do to the terrestrial vegetation? We found that autofertilization really enhances the photosynthetic capacity of these conifer trees, mainly Sitka spruce and western hemlock, and increases them by up to 2.5 times more than surrounding trees. So the number of needles, the photosynthetic capacity of a tree can put no needles out on a latrine is 2.5 times a nearby the same species. Not only that, but those trees that are fertilized by otters are responsible for the seed bank along the coast, because we put seed traps from the shoreline all the way to where basically you end up with cliffs and snow. And these are the number of seeds on as you go away from an otter latrine. This is, okay, otter latrines inland, and these are the same transects on random sites. And when you do DELAN 15, you see that these seeds actually come from fertilized trees. So otters are creating the seed bank in case there is some catastrophe that will kill the trees, these trees, they are responsible for the next generation, forest regeneration. But not all is good. Otter shading by these conifers reduces plant diversity. So only shade tolerant understory plants survive, and so diversity of understory plants goes down with increase in shading from otter fertilization. And actually otter activity at the latrines, you saw in the video that they all roll and rub, and all of this is to get salt water off their coat. So they bring a lot of salt onto the latrines. So actually diversity, plant diversity goes down as well because of salination. Okay. Back to the fairy tale. What will happen when the planet warms up? Anybody knows what this is? It's the blob. Sea surface temperature has been increasing. Not only land areas of our global warming, but also the oceans. In fact, we have a major problem with ocean warming. A lot of tropical fishes are starting to move north, and all the cold water specialist fishes are dying out or moving to the Arctic Ocean now that it's ice-free. Nearly. Basically, there is major die-off of fish and marine mammals and seabirds because of these increased sea surface temperatures that we somebody called, named the blob. And that's what we see in the Gulf of Alaska. We see a shift from cold water specialists. So as cold water specialists, all these types of fish are cold, and shellfish are cold water specialists. Their abundance is going down at the same time that more warm adapted species that are solitary and they don't spawn in large schools is going up. Just to point out, there is herring and sandlands and salmon are all going down. Here is again another illustration of how important these cold water pelagic fishes spawning in a near-shore environment is. Look at the size of these fish schools. Look at how many seabirds, humpback whales, people fish enormous amounts, huge biomass of this fish. And they're going away. So when the planet warms up and these schooling pelagic fishes disappear, so will sociality in river otters. Because it's not kinship, it's not anti-predator adaptation. Otters are forming these large groups to forage and capture these schooling pelagic fishes. We modeled this. We used an individual-based model that had no sociality lines of code in it. All it was, do you see a school fish? Can you catch the fish? Go to the next latrine and poop. Scent mark. That were the only, it's the simplest outcode you've ever seen in your life. And these are the results. When you have 100% of schools, this is the likelihood of fish, of otters encountering the fish. And that goes down with the availability of these schooling fish. And then a proportion time otters spend in groups goes down as well. Okay. And this is a paper I gave you guys to read. To show you that our model is reliable, we actually plotted the expectation per abundance of fish schools versus the counts of poop that we have obtained on the ground in 2006 and 2007. So, otters were injured by the Exxon Valdez oil spill. This is the abundance we calculated after the spill. This is when we declared them recovered. This is actually their carrying capacity. And this is where they're going down now. So what's the fairy tale? Basically, the availability of these forage fish influences, affects sociality. The latrine use is for intra-group communication. The social behavior creates a flux from sea to land of nutrients, important nutrients, that affects plant growth, especially photosynthetic capacity and carbon sequestration capacity of our coastal forests. And when the planet warms out, these fish will not be available. And with them will disappear sociality and the ability of our forests to sequester carbon forests goes down. Again, a multitude of students and colleagues and undergrads and a lot of funding from many, many agencies, including the Alaska Department of Fish and Game, Oil Spill Recovery Institute, UC Davis, Oil Care Network, NSF, Park Service, et cetera, really intensive collaboration of multiple agencies. And if you have any questions, I'll take them now, although I have one more last thing I'll say after the question.